Hi, and welcome back to our short course, Uncovering Causal Effects in Observational Data. As you know, I'm your instructor, Kevin Grier, and I'm very happy to have you taking this course with me. The reading for this section is Chapter 2 of our textbook, Mostly Harmless Econometrics, by Angrist and Pischke. Before we begin, I want to remind you that the course assumes a basic knowledge of linear regression. If you need a review of that topic, Sections 1 and 2 of Chapter 3 in the textbook are highly recommended. In this initial section, we are going to define the problem we are trying to solve in the course and explain why it is a difficult but important issue. To foreshadow, if we have to use data where the treatment that we wish to study was not assigned randomly, then we can easily uncover correlations between the treatment and some outcome variable, but we cannot infer from those correlations that the treatment is actually causing the outcome. To return to the example we used in the intro video, we can use survey data to find the correlation between smoking and wages and see that it is negative. But since the treatment, which is being a smoker, was not randomly assigned, we cannot jump from the correlation to a statement that smoking causes people to earn less at work. To put it another way, we want to know what would happen to a person if they stopped smoking, and comparing the wages of smokers and non-smokers is not a good way to get that answer. The reason is selection bias. If getting treatment, in our case smoking, is correlated with things that also affect the outcome, which is earnings, then the correlation between treatment and outcome is a biased measure of the causal effect of the treatment. Let me explain this. We know that education increases earnings. We also know that education is negatively correlated with being a smoker. So it's quite likely that educational status is driving the smoking earnings correlation in the data. If this is true, telling a high school dropout that stopping smoking will raise their wages is very unlikely to be true. Anything that affects both earnings and smoking status will cause the simple comparison of outcomes to be a biased estimate of the treatment effect. So at this point, you might be thinking, hey, we should just run a multiple regression with earnings on the left as our dependent variable and smoking status and education on the right as explanatory variables. That way, we can determine the effect of smoking on earnings controlling for education. Well, if education was the only factor affecting the outcome that also influenced selection into treatment, this regression approach would work. In practice, though, we'd have to make sure to include every variable that affected selection into treatment. This is a daunting task, even with a rich and detailed data set. And it doesn't solve the ultimate problem most statisticians worry about, which is that there are unobservable factors that can affect both the outcome and selection into treatment. A perfectly specified regression model can address selection on observable variables, but it cannot begin to deal with selection arising from unobservable factors. Unobservables are things that affect both the outcome and the selection into treatment that the researcher cannot see or measure. Things like motivation, peer pressure, innate ability, attitude toward risk, and many others. So no, it's unlikely that running a multiple regression will eliminate the problem of selection bias. Let's consider another example. Do hospital visits make people healthier? Well, as your textbook shows, the correlation between going to the hospital and reported health status is strong and negative. Does that mean going to hospitals makes you sicker? Well, maybe. But again, we have a problem with selection bias. Who tends to go to the hospital? Well, we know, people who are already sick. So being sick is correlated with the outcome, or health status, and correlated with selection into treatment, a class in case of selection bias, which of course means that the negative correlation between hospital visits and health status doesn't mean that going to the hospital makes you sicker. Fortunately, though, there are ways we can uncover true causal effects. Random assignment of treatment defeats the selection bias problem and allows us to recover causal effects of the treatment. If we assign hospital visits randomly across a large population, then the difference in health outcomes between the treated and the untreated would be a valid measure of the causal effects of hospitalization on health. You see, if we randomize treatment, then it won't be only sick people that go to the hospital. There will be the same proportion of sick people in both the treated and untreated groups. There will also be the same proportion of high earners, the same proportion of high school dropouts, et cetera, et cetera. Even unobservable factors will be occurring in the same proportion for the treated and the controls if treatment status is randomized. This is the logic behind how medical trials test whether a new drug or therapy is effective. The treatment is randomly assigned to the experimental population. The treated group gets the new drug, the control group gets a placebo. Since randomization means that the treated and control groups are basically identical, even on unobservables, the average difference in outcomes across the two groups gives us an unbiased estimate of the causal effect of the new drug on health. So randomization solves the selection problem. It eliminates the problem of selection bias we encounter in observational studies. Researchers often refer to randomized experiments as the gold standard of causal inference. And that's great, but But many important issues are not easily addressed with randomized experiments. For example, does fiscal austerity by governments improve economic performance in a crisis? This is a very important issue, but not at all amenable to experiments. We'd really like to know if austerity is good or bad in the face of a crisis. But could you imagine the World Bank or the United Nations randomly assigning countries to practice austerity and others not to? The issues with national sovereignty would overwhelm the scientific validity of the approach. The same goes for the question of the effects of smoking on income. The outcry about the National Institutes of Health randomly assigning people to smoke or not smoke would be immense, and rightly so, because we know that smoking is bad for your health. There are a mountain of cases where we really want to know the effect of some phenomenon or policy, but cannot use randomized experiments to establish the causal effect. And we know that just comparing outcomes between treated and untreated in the absence of randomization is invalid due to selection bias. This seems like a problem, no? Well, yeah, it's a serious problem, and it's precisely this problem our course addresses. Our methods are called quasi-experimental because they take observational data and try to get an answer as close as possible to the ideal of comparing outcomes across randomly assigned groups of treated and untreated units. Another way to talk about all this is to talk about counterfactuals. By that we mean what would have happened in the absence of treatment. When the treatment is not randomly assigned, the outcome of the untreated is not a valid counterfactual for what would have happened without the treatment. In the context of our smoking example, this is just a fancy way of saying the average earnings of non-smokers is not a valid estimate of what smokers would earn if they gave up smoking. Each of the four quasi-experimental methods we will learn and apply attempt to create a valid counterfactual for the treated group. In that way, we can compare the outcomes of the treated and the created control group to get a valid estimate of the treatment, even when the treatment was not randomly assigned. As we will see, the different methods vary in assumptions and applicability. One thing we will emphasize is determining which is best for a given situation or problem. We'll begin in the next session with the method of difference in difference. We'll explain the theory, show how to implement the method, and discuss several real-world applications. See you again soon.